Buddha's enlightenment, the beginning. The word enlightenment did not exist before Gautam the Buddha. It was he who coined the word enlightenment, and since then the season of the spring of enlightenment has begun. Buddha is also known as Tathagata, thus came, thus gone. When he was entering into Mahaparinirvana, someone asked, where would you go after you enter into Mahaparinirvana? Buddha took a lighted candle and blew it out. When he blew it out, he asked the seeker, where has the flame gone? Flame that was visible at the time, one moment before, is no more visible. But where has it gone? No one knows. Sufis say that is alam-e-ghaib. But it is somewhere. And then when you take the matchstick and you light it, the candle has the potentiality of getting lit again, again and again, until the wax melts away. And immediately, instantaneously it comes. Where has it come from? And that is why he was given the name, thus came, thus gone, Tathagata. He comes from nowhere, goes nowhere. At a time you all did not know about taoshobuddha, then all of a sudden someone discovered, and then the season started. I was existing but not known to you, and when I leave the world I will not be known to you, you will not be able to recognize. This is exhibited by the example of Jesus' resurrection when he appeared on top of the hill. Only those who have the heart invoked will be able to recognize, and it was only Mary Magdalene who recognized the presence of Jesus. A flower that has never known about the sun, and the flower that has experienced the magnanimity of sun, are not seen. There is a vast difference between the two. Indeed, they cannot be the same, because a flower that has never witnessed the rising sun can never feel the rising sun within. When something happens outside, parallel to that, something begins to happen within. Such a flower that has not experienced the rising sun, it has potentiality, but potentiality has not attained fruition. It is dead. It has never known its own spirit. When a seeker comes, his heart is dead. It has to be invoked to receive the right kind of vibrations and experiences. And that is what in Sufi terminology we call the invoking of the heart center. A flower that has witnessed the sunrise has also seen something arise within itself. It has discovered its own soul. Now this flower is no more an ordinary flower. The flower has known a deep happening within. This is the destiny of each one of you. Flower of your being has to attain fruition. And the ultimate in the fruition of your being is enlightenment. To create this inner sun of awakening within, Buddha invented a technique of meditation almost 25 centuries ago. This technique not only creates the inner sun of awareness, but at the same time, it also allows the awareness to penetrate into every cell of the body, and then to the entire being. The technique that Buddha invented is known as Anapana Sati Yoga, or in common terminology as Vipassana meditation. It comes from the two words, Vi and Passana. Vi means neutral, without any judgment, and Passana means to see. This Passana is not ordinary way of looking. It is looking with a non-judgmental eye. And when you are looking at something without any judgment, it becomes witnessing. But witnessing begins with watchfulness. If I say watchfulness is the childhood of witnessing, it is no exaggeration. Watchfulness is the beginning, and slowly, mindfulness is the beginning. Then watchfulness comes in. Vipassana means look at everything with a neutral attitude, neutral approach. Vipassana is also known as insight meditation. It was discovered by Buddha to unravel the questions arising in his mind to know truth. His only interest was the problems that man was inflicted upon, how to find the answers. And he was not seeking the answers in the scriptures. He sought the answers within. The word enlightenment and nirvana both were introduced by Buddha. Before him, the experience existed. However, it was more implicit. Buddha gave the first glimpse of inner flowering. Thus, he opened the way for inner flowering of consciousness. Enlightenment is one shore of the river wherein the consciousness moves after enlightenment happens. The other shore comes beyond enlightenment. Just as Fana and Baka are two shores for Sufism, enlightenment and beyond enlightenment are the two shores wherein an enlightened one continues to live. It is an interesting story, anecdote, what had happened at the time. The king, Buddha's father, was of an advanced age. He did not have any children. His wife Maya Devi forced him to get married to her sister Prajapati so that the lineage can continue. But it happened that both Prajapati and Maya had the children, had the boys. Maya was the one who had the first child that came to be known as Siddhartha Gautama. Before Buddha was born, his mother Maya had a dream of white elephant with six tuskers. In the dream, the elephant dissolved into her. About 10 months after her dream, a white elephant and the sign that she would give birth to a great being. Maya was expecting her child. One day she went to the king and said, "I have to go to my parents. My body is almost due." Since it was customary in India for a wife to have her baby in her father's home, the king agreed, saying, "Very well, I'll make the necessary arrangements for you to go." The king then sent soldiers ahead to clear the road and prepared others to guard the queen as she was carried in a decorated carriage. The queen left the kingdom of Kapilvastu in a long procession of soldiers and retainers, headed for the capital of her father's kingdom that lie at the foot of Nepal. On the way, when she reached the Kolya country, on the way to Kolya country where her father lived, the procession had to pass through a garden called Lumbini Park. The garden was near the kingdom of Nepal, at the foot of Himalayan Mount. The beautiful park spread its beauty with its tall sal trees, a large subdeciduous tree. It is up to 30 meters in height. Sal tree is seldom completely leafless. It has a large leathery leaves and yellowish scented flower and busy birds and bees. This attracted the queen. Since the park was a good resting place, queen ordered the bearers to stop for a while. As she rested underneath one of the sal trees, her birth began and a baby boy was born. She rested under the sal tree, the birth process began, and she gave birth to a baby boy. It was an auspicious day, full moon. The birth took place on a full moon day, which is now celebrated as the festival of triple events of Buddha's birth. At the age of 40, Buddha got enlightened, attained to enlightenment. And on the same full moon night, at the age of 80, in 623 BC, Buddha entered Mahaparinirvana. According to the legends about this birth, the baby, it is said, began to walk and took 7 steps forward. At each step, a lotus flower appeared on the ground. Then at the 7th stride, he stopped and with a noble voice shouted, "I am chief of the world. Eldest am I in the world. Foremost am I in the world." Each one of us is the oldest, but you are not aware of it because you consider yourself to be the body and the mind. Body has an age, mind has an age, but the age of the mind is more than that of the body, and that of consciousness is eternal, never born, never died. It simply changes the form. This is, and Buddha, the voice said, this is the last birth. There is now no more coming to be in new at the time of the birth. Buddha was born, his father was of a well advanced age. Astrologers were called in, as it is customary. The astrologers and priests, they seek rewards from the king. So they have to say things that will please the king. One of the younger astrologers said that Buddha would leave the kingly splendor in search of truth. This did not appeal to the king, so he was not rewarded. While the other astrologer, who was older, suggested ways to change the destiny, it was suggested that he be married. And at the time of Buddha was born, the ceremony was taking place. An enlightened mystic Asit came from nowhere and he wanted to have a look at the newborn baby. He said, "Whatsoever you do, this child will relinquish the kingdom and he will be the enlightened one." At an early age, Buddha was married. And it was made sure that nothing unusual be allowed to happen around him, because seeing a leaf fall, a question may arise, why does the leaf turn yellow, why does it fall? Many of us see things like that, but only an inquisitive mind inquires about such metaphysical questions. So he was married to Yashodhara, and around the palace where he was living, all dried leaves were picked up before sunrise. All arrangements were made so that no unusual question would arise in his mind. However, Buddha had not come to rule any kingdom. One night, he first saw an old man, then a sick person, and finally a dead body. That was the destined night. It is said that these three men were the enlightened masters of the past who came to guide and pave the way for Buddha. He questioned his charioteer about these events. He was told such is the destiny of each human being. Buddha did not return to the palace that night. He decided to seek the answer to these questions. So he embraced the life of a wandering ascetic. He cut off his hair lock, took off his kingly splendor clothes, returned the horse, and asked his charioteer to take these back. And he went in search of the truth. It is important, unless you are fed up with the rut of the world, your search of truth will not begin. If you still hanker for the world, its pleasures and things like these, your search for truth will not begin. And once you are fed up of this, you are detached from the world. You may live in the world, but the world will not be living in you. Your life will be totally different than that of others. My truth cannot be yours. Each one of you will have to continue your journey so that truth can be discovered. Truth is not a ready-made answer. It's not that you can find in the scriptures. You read any of the scriptures and you will find truth. That is why it is said, the experience of truth has to come to each one of you. Hinduism is broad enough and accepts it that every single individual has to discover the truth. Islam does not allow. When Al-Ilaj Mansur said, announced, Anilhaq, I am the light, I am the truth, it was not accepted. He was crucified. Christianity does not exist. It is something like this, this simple fact. You cannot experience the bliss of the married life unless you go into that. By reading about those who have gone, who have entered into that, will not give you the experience. Umar Khayyam has a beautiful couplet. Kya ho hasil unke zikr se jo peekar mast hue hain. If you want to enjoy the wine, you have to drink yourself. What shall you gain, O fool, by talking about those who are drunk and gone? If you really enjoy, know what wine can do to you. You have to drink it on your own. Each one of you, truth is that eternal wine that is brewed by the sake every moment. And you have to drink on your own. Each one of you will have to continue your journey so that truth can be discovered. It is not a ready-made answer. First you have to discover it and then live it. Only then your being will attain to its fruition. Knowing truth is one thing. Living truth complements that. And when you have discovered your truth and start living it, then the inward journey begins. Then one day the fruition happens, and that fruition is enlightenment. At the time when Buddha entered into the path, it was believed that there were two major techniques of meditation. First of these techniques was of concentration. This involved experiencing various stages of meditative observations. This is called Dhyan Yoga or Gyan Yoga. Buddha went to two masters of the time to learn this. In the process, he attained the highest state of Dhyan, yet still he was far from the truth or Dharma. So he asked his teachers if they had anything more to offer. But they were honest enough to say no. Buddha did all that was needed to attain the highest spiritual state. But nothing happened. He left them. Then he came across the other form of meditative practice, which was also used at that time. This was the practice of self-mortification or self-torture. It was believed then that by tormenting the body, the self or ego would vanish. This could be accomplished in several ways, including fasting, lying on the bed of nails. Buddha went through all these techniques. He was determined to do all that was needed to attain the truth. Buddha tried for 6 years continuously to know what the divine is. And it cannot be said that he left anything undone. You go to a priest and he tells you something to do. When it does not happen, he tells you, you have not done this correct. You have supposed to do it this way. But there was no fault in Buddha, what he was doing, because everyone was watching what Buddha was doing. And he was so total into that, that the masters have to say that they know nothing beyond that. Buddha was no ordinary being. and he did everything that was humanly possible. Even some things which seem humanly impossible, he did everything. Whatever was known up to his day, he practiced. Whatsoever methods were taught to him, he became a master there. He went to all the masters that existed in his time, to everyone. And whatsoever they could teach, he learned, practiced. And then he said, "Anything more, sir?" And the master had to say, "Now you can go, because all that I could give you, I have given. I cannot say, as I say in other cases, that you have not practiced. You have practiced, and this is all I can give you." Buddha said, "But I have not known the divine as yet. The truth is not revealed." For 6 years he wandered. His last master was Alarkala. For 6 months Buddha lived on one grain of rice. He practiced the fasting intensely. Nothing happened. After a long period of fasting, he became very frail and weak. You cannot imagine how frail and weak he was. He had a beautiful body. He was born in a kingly clan, and the body became frail and weak. Then he invented his own method. Continuously for 6 years he was in the struggle of life and death. He did everything that could be done. Then at last he was so tired of doing. So deadly tired that one day, when he was taking his evening bath in the Niranjana river near Bodh Gaya. This Niranjana river is shallow, a stony river. He felt so and so tired that he could not come out of the river. He just clung to the root of the tree that was leaning from the other side of the bank, and thought came to his mind. "I have become so weak. I cannot even cross this small river. How will I be able to cross the whole ocean of the world? I have done everything and I have not found the divine. I have only tired my body." He felt that he was on the verge of death. At that very moment, he felt that he had done everything and now there is nothing else remaining to do. In the beginning, you have to begin with effort. When effort reaches its culmination, then relaxation of a different quality happens. You are trying to remember a particular address. You make every single possible effort. You stress your mind left, right, every way. But the word is not coming. And all of a sudden you get tired and you leave it. You go and have a cup of tea or read the newspaper. All of a sudden the address surfaces. The two things have to go together. Your effort has to reach its culmination. No halfway thing can ever be possible. When your effort reaches its culmination, a point comes, then you realize the futility of the effort. That very moment you leave the effort, then all of a sudden something happens. Grass grows by itself, but you must do your utmost, all the efforts to nourish and nurture it. But grass will grow on its own. He felt that he was on the verge of death. At that very moment, he felt that he had done everything and now there was nothing to do. He was fed up of doing. Now he entering the realm of non-doing. He relaxed. A new energy came upon him because of this relaxation. All that was suppressed through those 6 years flowered. He came out of the river. He felt just like a feather, a bird's feather. Weightless, he relaxed under a bodhi tree. He had no energy to live, to move or anything. He was lying half unconscious under a banyan tree when he was discovered by a cowherd boy. The young boy realized that the recluse must have been fasting for a long time and that had weakened his body. But Buddha did not see the boy. The boy was wise enough to give milk to Buddha But Buddha was so weak that he could not open his mouth. The boy hesitated to touch Buddha, as he belonged to a lower caste. But realizing the situation, he decided that even though it was a sin to touch Buddha, it was more important to save him. He could ask for forgiveness afterwards. Buddha felt better after drinking the milk and was finally able to move. He saw the boy sitting next to him respectfully. So Buddha inquired who he was. The boy said he was a cowherd and asked for forgiveness. Buddha consoled the boy. He told him that he had not done anything wrong. Instead, he had done everything right and there was no need to ask for forgiveness. Further, Buddha said, we are not good or bad simply because we are born in a lower height. Our goodness depends on our actions. Our goodness depends on our understanding, on our awareness. And if awareness is there, that nothing wrong will come out of your mind, you may practice goodness, you may practice good deeds, but if it is not part of you, if it has not emanated, we see people all around, their outer behavior is one, and then what is going on in their mind is something different. But you cannot escape this from the magnified eyes of a master. The moment a person appears, the gestures, the mannerism reveals the inner state. Further, Buddha said, we are not good or bad simply because we are born in a low and high family. Our goodness depends on our actions, thoughts and consciousness. So Buddha stayed under the tree. In the evening, he heard a song coming from the nearby forest. This song was being sung by a group of girls who were collecting firewood in the forest. The song meant, if the strings of the musical instrument were too tight, they would break on being used. Also, if the strings were too loose, the moment the instrument would not make the right sound. The string would have to be neither too tight nor too loose. This gave Buddha the insight into the middle path. Buddha saw the futility of the extreme paths that he was taught. The extreme paths. Also, the danger of attachment to them. So he decided to pursue the middle path himself. He realized the significance of the middle path. Then he went to Niranjana River and sat on the bank to meditate and discover the middle path. It is said Buddha wanted to cross the river, but he was so weak that he fell into it. It was a shallow, stony river. He held on to the branch of the tree leading from the other shore. Thought about the futility of his actions of the past few days. He thought, now I am so weak. What would I be able to do if enlightenment happened? He could not sleep. He remained awake whole night, watching the stars disappear in the sky. Somehow he came out of the river. He made a seat of grass under a Bodhi tree and sat for meditation. It was a bright full moon night. Someone, a girl named Sujata, the name shows that the girl must have been of a low caste, because to have the name Sujata means she had not come from a higher class. That means well born. She had promised the Bodhi tree to pay it some homage daily. So she had come with some sweet rice and different other items. Buddha is there, tired, pale, bodiless, but relaxed. There was a different kind of splendor and aura around him. Sujata felt that it was the effort of her good deeds that God has appeared in front of her, absolutely unburdened. And full night, as it was approaching, nobody around. Buddha was sitting alone. The girl Sujata felt that the deity of the tree had come to receive her homage. Had it been another day, Buddha could have refused. He would not rest in the night. He would not eat any food. But today he was totally relaxed. He took the food and he slept. This was the first night after 6 years that he really slept. It is said a woman came by to offer him some food as the offering of her good fortune. She thought that gods had come to her in this human form of a holy man sitting under the Bodhi tree. She offered Buddha excellent food in 49 pieces on a beautiful platter. Buddha ate all that was offered and then again began to meditate. Without any further need for nourishment, it was now sunset. He decided not to move again until enlightenment happened. He had eaten already and there was no need for him to move. That night, near about midnight, Buddha was strongly tempted by Maya or the illusion. In Buddhist terminology, it is known as Mara. It is the symbol of all obstructing forces. Mara had three daughters, desire, lust, and aversion. They came to persuade him to leave the path of meditation and return to the palace and become king. This did not affect Buddha, who was tranquil. This made Mara angry. So he sent his armies by land and air to frighten Buddha. This was the question from Sajit, the ego. Ego is illusion. It always tempts. It happened in case of Jesus. First it came as serpent. Then it came in a different form. It keeps on changing the form, and depending on individual intelligence at the moment of thought expression, its expression may differ. This did not affect Buddha as he was tranquil, but this made Mara angry, so he sent his armies by land and air to frighten Buddha. He became afraid. He opened his eyes and raised his hand to ward off the attack, but then he realized there was no one. They were in fact his hallucinations. Ego is always your hallucination. Ignorance is your hallucination. He was relaxed with nothing to do. Then there was no worry. There was no tomorrow even because tomorrow exists only because one has to do something. If one has nothing to do, then there is no need for tomorrow. I am finished for the day. When I am finished for the day, I can relax. I have done all that was necessary for me to be done for that particular moment. So sometimes I may go to sleep at 6 o'clock because my day's work is finished. Then the moment alone is enough. Buddha slept. And in the morning at about 5 o'clock, when the last star was withering away, he was out of his sleep. He saw the last star disappear with no mind. Because when you have nothing to do, there is no mind. The mind has disappeared because there is no thought what to do tomorrow, what to cook in the evening. When the evening comes, then we will see. But our whole planning goes on what to cook next. Lunch is over and you start preparing for dinner. The mind is just a faculty of doing a technical faculty. No mind, nothing to do, no effort on his part. Indifferent to whether he was alive or dead, he just opened his eyes. He had come to that knowing to which he could not come through so many efforts. He had come to that knowing to which he could not come through many efforts. Same time, Sujata, the noble woman, and the cowherd boy all came. They saw a different kind of a splendor on Buddha. Buddha continued his meditation. He was tranquil and restful. He meditated, watching his mind until dawn, when each star in the sky had disappeared. With this, something dawned on him. Buddha got a clear insight and inner understanding of all the phenomena, both within and without. Enlightenment happened at that very time. The thing which Buddha was waiting for years happened that very precise moment. It was during meditation Buddha discovered the technique of vipassana or insight meditation, that is Buddha's gift of enlightenment to humanity. And since then it cannot be improved. Meditation is such that it not only creates an inner awareness, instead simultaneously allows the awareness to penetrate to the very cells of the body, to the whole of one's being. It is also called Anapanasati Yoga or Vipassana Meditation. That brings awareness to incoming and outgoing breath. You have nothing to do, just sit down and watch your incoming breath and outgoing breath. It is an effort in mindfulness, effort in witnessing. You have to witness, cannot happen overnight. You have to start with watchfulness, then next stage is mindfulness, then witnessing becomes natural. It is based on constant or attentive awareness. We attach various meanings to awareness. We have to be clear about its meaning. When Buddha spoke of breath awareness, he meant to look attentively without applying any knowledge or information. It means that we simply look with a quiet mind, without making any comment or applying knowledge, interpretation or explanation. The art of neutral observation is not so easy. By doing so, we can see that the mind can be emptied of its content. Then we can understand the way the mind works and also examine the contents of the mind. This is the way to meet everything fully with the whole being and with all energy that you have. Then there is no more dissipation of energy. The energy dissipates because of the mind and the thought process that continuously goes on. For years we keep on nourishing one thought. Why this happened to me? Why this man do that to me? Why did he pay me less and he is enjoying everything? With that, you do not have the energy that is needed for inward journey. When something is finished, the thought should vanish from your mind. But we continue to nourish and nurture these thoughts. And when the mind is no more, no content, no thoughts. That is why Shankar says, Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham Mano Buddhi Ahankar Chittani Naham. I am neither the mind, nor the intellect, nor the ego sense, nor the storehouse of the memory. But what are you? The storehouse of the memory. Lust, greed, anger. All these are attributes with which you continue to live into the world on a moment to moment. And the energy begins to dissipate into it. When there is no content, no thoughts, no anger, no jealousy, no greed, whatsoever is, whatsoever is not, then there cannot be any dissipation of energy. And it can be directed for looking at what is going on. Witnessing begins. This is looking beyond appearances. It is significant to understand that we are simply looking at, not looking for. There is a vast difference between looking at and looking for. When we are looking at, there is no more expectation, which is an aspect of looking for. Looking for is always with expectation. If we look for something in meditation, then there is expectation. Disappointment is bound to come. This will lead to clinging, loss of energy and mental imbalance. It is important to look attentively and silently. This will bring clear understanding and insight into the nature and contents of the mind. And by understanding your own mind, you can understand the entire cosmos. Buddha explained the same in one of the sutras. These sutras are related to mindfulness, the sutras on mindfulness. Buddha explained that awareness is only for intuitive understanding and awareness itself, not for anything else. Intuitive insights gradually develops along the path of awareness. We may see that this incorporates three main factors, namely attention, awareness, and watchfulness. These three words explain the technique of insight. Insight is developed if we follow this properly. In other words, when the meditation is done in the right way. However, in the early stages, insight is closely connected with intellect. This is mainly because of conflicts within and the knowledge that we have. But with insight, we come to understand what we know. Insight gets deeper. And thus it revealed the difference between the insight itself and the function of intellect. The two go on cooperating in deep meditation. But this is quite different from that we have known originally. Intellect gets still and becomes receptive when insight operates. Now intellect will pick up the signal given by the insight, words and concept. The process continues. We need to allow intellect to be quiet and passive. Then intellect becomes subservient to insight. It can no more remain active all the time. When intellect is unduly active, we cannot attain the emptiness of the mind. That is why Shankar says, Mano Buddhi, I am not the intellect either. Beyond that, this seeing is insight, and that is the meaning of the word vipassana. To begin the process, we need to cultivate our attention, and in developing this attention, we need some primary object as focus. In vipassana, we use the rise and fall of breath as preliminary object. We need not regulate the breath. We need not do anything with the breath. Just let it be as it is. Let the breath move in and out as naturally as possible without any interference of the mind. When you are upset, the breathing is of a different nature. You are watching it. As the breath moves in and out, observe the rise and fall. This is the first step for the mind. To see the nature of the rise. The nature of the rising and passing away in the physical sense of breathing. As an individual, we go on breathing unconsciously. Breath is prana, the life force. Breath is Alan Vaite. Yet still breathing is unconscious. We are unaware of it. If we were to be aware of breathing in order to breathe, we would die. Sooner or later, we would forget. Thus, we cannot remember anything continuously. Breathing establishes a connection between our voluntary and non-voluntary systems. We can, however, control our breathing to some extent. At times, we can even stop breathing for a while, but no way can we stop breathing permanently. It goes on without any effort on our part. One can be in coma for months, yet still breathing goes on. Breathing is an unconscious mechanism. There are two aspects of breathing, the incoming breath and the outgoing breath. When you breathe in and pause, there is a gap, and then you breathe out. After you breathe out, there comes another gap. Before you start breathing in or inhaling again, therefore there are two gaps. The first gap happens within you after the breath has come. This creates a center within. This is known as your soul or inner center. The other happens when the breath is out and waiting to come in. This gap is called cosmic center, or according to Hindus as Paramatma. If the breath that has gone out does not come in, it is referred to as death, while the gap between is called life. Buddha used breath as a vehicle for two things. First, to create consciousness, and second, allow this consciousness to penetrate to the very cells of the body. Breathe consciously was Buddha's message. Buddha never meant pranayama. the breathing techniques. It was meant to make breath an object of awareness, but not changing it. There is no need to change the breath. Leave it as it is, just natural. The only necessary thing is breathe consciously. As the breath comes in, allow the consciousness to move in. Just as William Reich says, when you breathe in, the life force comes in. But Buddha says, as the breath comes in, allow the consciousness to move in. Consciousness or the life force is same, two different interpretations of the same word. And let the consciousness move out with the outgoing breath. Let there be total attention on breath. Move with it, flow with it. Never forget even for a single breath. Buddha is reported to have said that if you can be aware of your breath for even 1 hour, you are already enlightened. But never let a single breath be missed. I am talking on Buddha's way. Do not seek parallels in others. Had my role was that of a professor of comparative study, I would have told you. But at this moment, when my role is that of a master, to allow the inward journey, I will not mention of any parallels, and also my advice is not to seek any parallels. Definitely 1 hour seems like a small fragment of time, but it is not so. When you are trying to be aware, 1 hour seems like a millennium. It is so because generally you cannot be aware of your breath for more than 5 to 6 seconds. Only one alert person can be aware for that long. We miss awareness every moment. You can start awareness with incoming breath, but no sooner the breath has come in, you are somewhere else, and suddenly you realize that you were to breathe consciously, but the breath has gone out and you were somewhere else. To be conscious of breath simply means that no thought can be allowed. Thoughts distract your attention. Buddha never said to stop thinking. His only emphasis was on conscious breathing. And when you breathe consciously, thoughts cease automatically. You cannot breathe consciously and think at the same time. As thought comes in your mind, your attention is withdrawn from the breathing. A single thought is more than enough to make you unconscious of the breathing. This technique seems very simple, but it is vital. Buddha told his monks to do whatsoever, but not to forget one simple thing, the incoming and the outgoing breath. As you continue to do this frequently, you will grow in consciousness. It is difficult. But once you have done this, you can no longer remain the same person. You will be a different person and a different being. As you begin to breathe in and out consciously, by and by, you move to your center. It is so because each time you breathe in, your breath and with the breath, the life force touches the very center of your being. Psychologically, you think that breath just purifies the blood. It is a bodily function, but it is not so. When you begin to be aware of breathing, by and by, you go deeper than physiology. Then one day you will begin to feel your center right near your navel. You can feel your center only when you move with the breath continuously. You have to continue because as you reach nearer this center, it will be even more difficult to remain aware. You can start with the breath. You can start when the breath is entering, when it almost touching the nostrils. Be aware of it. As it moves inward, awareness will be more difficult. A thought may come in, or a sound, or something else may happen, and you move away from the awareness. If you can reach to the very center for a brief moment, breath stops. And then comes in. The breath comes in and then goes out. Between these two, there is a subtle gap. This gap is your center, the center of your being. It is only after practicing this breath awareness for a sufficiently long period of time you will be able to remain with the breath. You can be aware of the gap only when there is no breath moved. Now, breath is neither coming in nor going out. Between these two, there is a subtle gap. Between these two breaths, you are at your center. Thus, breath awareness was used by Buddha as a means to reaching to the center. And these are the techniques that has been mentioned in Vigyan Bhairav Tantra by Shiva. Be conscious when you breathe out. Again, there is a gap. In fact, there are two gaps. One comes after the breath comes in and before it goes out. Another gap comes in when the breath is out and before it comes. This second gap is more difficult to be aware. And between these two incoming and outgoing breaths lies your center. However, there is another center, the cosmos. You may call this as God. The cosmic center lies between when the breath goes out and before it comes. However, these two centers are not two different things. In the process, first you become aware of your center and then you become aware of the center outside or the cosmic center. Then one day ultimately you know that these two centers are one. Two sides of the same coin. Two shores of the river between which consciousness flows. Thus the outer and inner lose their significance. Buddha says move consciously with the breath, then you will create a center of awareness within yourself. As the center is created, awareness will begin to move to your every cell and provide nourishment to the cells, as every cell needs oxygen. It can be said that each cell breathes. Even the earth breathes, says scientists, with the universe breathing in and the earth expanding, and when the universe breathes out, the earth contracts. According to Hindu scriptures, creation is Brahma's single incoming breath, and destruction or dissolution is Brahma's outgoing breath. There are three aspects of anything that is going on. They are rising, existing and falling away. In case of breathing, it can be said that there is a cessation of breath. This can lead to a silence and therefore it is possible for us to transcend consciousness of it. It seems that breathing automatically stops, but it is not so. Breathing gets deeper and even then you breathe internally and do not feel the when you do not see the gentle movement, it is said that breathing has stopped. So when silence becomes more significant or intense, then you transcend the consciousness of breathing. In that case, do not cling to the object. The preliminary object is only to start with. Naturally, you tend to pay attention to the immediate object that is at. Thus, there is no need to set object. Everything that enters the consciousness eventually becomes the object of meditation. We identify with attention, awareness and watchfulness. In this process, we are not observed. And when we begin with meditation, both mind and the body discharge. However, we have to know what is happening. Knowing just for the sake of knowledge and for doing anything. Awareness is at work, but we are not. When you sit in meditation for long, your legs tend to go to sleep. You will get concerned about it. Let the legs go to sleep, but keep the body in an upright position. Mind goes to rest. Sometimes the leg may wake up, but you should remain unconcerned. And do not move because of the pain or discomfort. If you move, you cannot observe all that is going on mind. The body will certainly feel the discomfort. In that situation, go on looking constantly, and then a point will come when knowing happens. So no more doing, instead seeing alone. Also, when you are sitting in the rain, let the raindrops fall and just observe what is happening in your body and the mind. Feel your attitude. When a situation arises, do not look for any technique or to get to that situation. Be in that situation completely, because without it, you cannot learn. Life is always open. Life has both shallow and deeper moments. Go through every aspect of life, expect nothing, but take things as they are and as they come. In this form of meditation, keep your eyes closed, keep your attention steady, and focus on the rise and fall of the breath. In the Eastern monasteries, before meditation begins, a bell is rung 3 times, and one has to listen to the sound from the beginning to the end. Follow the sound and be aware of the continuity of hearing. When meditation begins, there are fears and uncertainties. Buddha narrated a story to his monks to help them in practice. He said, once a man came across 4 poisonous snakes, symbolic of water, earth, fire and wind. He became afraid. To escape them, he ran into a village expecting some help. There he did not find anyone. This made him even more fearful and uncertain as well. He ran until he came across a vast stretch of water. He did not know what to do. There was no boat to take him to the other shore. He became even more frightened. He decided to take a raft. He collected some reeds and branches and made a raft. Then he started his journey. On reaching the other shore, he abandoned the raft he was now free to enjoy himself on this new island. Something like the above happens in meditation. In the beginning, it may be like trying to escape from these poisonous snakes. Sooner or later, we shall arrive at a challenging situation. In that situation, we cannot rely on anything. Nothing is available. But then, when we look into ourselves, we can bring about everything we need and build a raft. Buddha told monks that this raft was for crossing the ocean of life, not to cling to it. When you use the boat to cross the river and on reaching to the other shore, you have to leave the boat, not to cling it. When there is clinging, grasping and attachment, then you may stay in the ocean or you may even drown. Also, you cannot carry it with you as you set foot on the other shore. Then it will become an unnecessary burden. All techniques are for help flow. And once you have reached to the other shore, everything has to be abandoned. When you try to hold on to them, you become rigid and fixed. There is no movement possible. All such techniques are successful, but never fix yourself on them. When you are fixed on any specific teaching, then you become narrow-minded. When you are sick, you take a treatment and medicine, and you follow a particular pattern of treatment and take precautions. But once you are cured, you do not carry the prescriptions anymore. All your prescriptions, treatment and medicines are dropped there. So when you are fixed, you are narrow-minded, no more openness, no flexibility, no adaptability. When you want to move from one position to another, be always open. In that case, awareness becomes stronger. In Buddhism, this is known as self-reliance. Whenever someone would ask him how he achieved, he would say, the more I tried to achieve, the more I was at loss. I could not achieve, so how can I say that I have achieved? The more I tried, the more I was involved. I could not achieve. The mind was trying to transcend itself, which was impossible. It is just like trying to be a father to yourself and trying to give birth to yourself. So Buddha would say, I cannot say I achieved. I can only say that I tried so much that was annihilated. I tried to so much that any effort became absurd. And the moment came when I was not trying, when the mind was not, when I was not thinking, then there was no future because there was no past. Both were always together. Past is behind, future is in front. They are always conjoined. If one drops, the other drops simultaneously. Then there is no future, no past, no mind. I was mindless. I was eyeless. when something happened, and I cannot say that something happened, and I cannot say that this something happened in that moment. I can only say that this was always happening, only I was not aware of it. It was always happening, only I was closed. So I cannot say I have achieved something. Buddha said, I can only say I have lost something, the ego, the mind, and I have not attained anything. I have not achieved it. Now I know that all that I have was always there. It was in every layer. It was in every stone, in every flower. But now I recognize that it was always. Only I was blind. So I have lost my blindness. I have not achieved anything. I have lost everything. If you begin with the divine, then you will begin to achieve. If you begin with yourself, then you begin to lose. Things will begin to disappear, and ultimately you will disappear. And when you are not, the divine is, with all its grace, with all its love, with all its compassion. But only when you are not, your non-existence is the categorical condition. It is the absolute. You are the back, fall down, and then you know. And only when you know, you know. You cannot understand it. I cannot explain it to you. I cannot make you understand it. So whatsoever I am saying, I am not saying anything metaphysical. I am only trying to show you that you must begin yourself. If you begin with yourself, you will end with the divine, because that is the other part, the other pole. But begin with this path. Do not begin with the other path, where you are not. You cannot begin from there. Begin where you are, and the more you will go deep, and less you will be. There is a beautiful book written by Kazanza, Zorba the Buddha. You are Zorba as well as Buddha. You are the more you will know yourself, the less a self you will be. And once you have come to total understanding about yourself, you will be annihilated. You will go into non-existence. You will be totally negative and negative not. And in that not, in that total negation, you will know the grace which is always falling, which is always raining down from the eternity. You will know the love which is always around you. It has always been, but you have not paid any attention to it. Be annihilated and you will be aware of it.